Why do birds suddenly appear every time you are near?
I always just considered ourselves lucky. I mean, we're musicians that happen to have a lucky break, really. You know, I mean, we could still be working local gigs and nightclubs or something. And so I never had the feeling like we deserved it. And the more that would happen, well, of course it should. I never felt like that at all. Tried to tell myself that if it ever did, because you keep hearing stories about how people change and success spoils, so on and so forth, you know, and that if it ever did happen, I try to remember back to when we were just struggling and lifting amps and auditioning and everything else, and just try to, you know, stay the same.
We've only just begun to live. White lace and promises, a kiss for luck and we're on our way.
We've only begun
before the rising sun. Just begun.
But I remember one thing when we first started. Remember when we're signed like with A&M Records, and Herb Alpert is the one who signed us, and we were so taken with him when we first met him. I mean, it was like just standing there with your mouth open, you know. And I remember the one thing that he said in relating to this fame thing. He said that you always got to remember that as fast as you came up, it can flop as fast, and you can be back sweeping the streets. You know, remember when he said that? And that always stuck with me.
Yeah, he always, he seemed to maintain his
never
cool,
changed
really. He didn't change at all. He was a really average guy after all that success,
and that impressed us
a lot.
Yeah, so you kept your feet on the ground, and again, the thing that is always brought up is the image of the Carpenters. Mm-hmm. Is it for real, or is it something that's being carefully manufactured?
It was just something that the image that we carry to a point is true, but
it's done up
it
a little
tends
too,
to
it's
go,
overdone in
yeah.
the press.
I mean, like we are, you know, was normal mean. Our audience that we have would never think that we would like Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention. Mm. I mean, we're like everybody else. We get hot at something, and you're just going to say what you normally say. I mean, you know, naturally, you don't go around screaming it in the middle of the street, but I mean, there's a point that anybody can get to, and I don't care who they are. They're themselves, and
we're not that square.
What I feel is come and gone before. No need to talk it out. We know what's all about.
Wouldn't you rather have a more real you presented to the
public?
Yeah, but
you see, this is something, a brother-sister act, you know, right smack in the middle of the hard rock thing when it happened, was something that had never happened. I mean, a brother-sister act, period, hadn't happened. So, like, nobody knew how to photograph it, so they immediately went for the old married Stephen Eady shots, you know, of the cheeks together smiling, because they didn't know what else to do with it. And then the whole thing with us being sort of soft sounding in the middle of the hard stuff, which we enjoy, that the whole thing really got blown out of proportion as to, you know, being squeaky clean apple pie, never dreaming of saying, shit.
Thank you.
It got overdone.
Do you see a time coming in the future when you're going to adjust this, when you're going to get in there?
Well, we're trying to, because I've had my fill of having it overdone in the wrong direction, you know, and so...
We have been for a while, you know, it's, you know, people think you don't do anything, you don't smoke, you don't drink, nothing, you know, like, personally, we don't smoke, but it's not because... it's just because it's something we don't like. I mean, but if I did like to smoke, I would, you know, but people think you never touch a drop of, I mean, we're not alcoholics or anything, but we like wine. But it's
and
really...
Before I went on losing a bunch of weight, I used to have a beer every now and then, and yet some fan got into a rehearsal when we were in Tulsa, Oklahoma. It was about 100 degrees. No lie. I mean, it was... really hot. It was in the middle of summer. We had a bunch of beer there, and I had a beer, and the fan saw me drinking a beer and wrote a letter.
Yeah.
How dare the Carpenters drink a beer? I mean, what's this going to do to their image? What an image. Beer is one of the most all-American baseball game, average Joe, have a beer. I mean, what's wrong with having a beer? But these people, they get this idea that you wouldn't do anything.
Such a feeling's coming over me. There is wonder in most everything I see. Not a cloud in the sky, got the sun in my eyes, and I won't be surprised if it's a dream. Everything I want the world to be is now coming true, especially for me. And it's clear, it's because you are here. You're the nearest thing to heaven that I've seen. I'm on the top of the world, looking down on creation, and the only explanation I can find is the love that I've found ever since you've been around. Your love's put me at the top of the world. Something in the wind has learned my name, and it's telling me that things are not the same. In the leaves on the trees and the touch of the breeze, there's a pleasing sense of happiness for me. There is only one wish on my mind. When this day is through, I hope that I will find that tomorrow will be just the same for you and me. Since you've been around, your love's put me at the top of the world.
I'm on the top,
top of the world.
Looking
down on creation, and the only explanation I can find is the love that I've found ever since you've been around. Your love's put me at the top of the world.
But do you see songs today as being a vehicle for social comment because they're such a powerful medium? Do you see that?
No, I think the social comment thing in the whole is passé. The thing, like, I remember the big one was Society's Child. I don't know if that was a hit here. The Janice Ian thing that was banned from the radio until Leonard Bernstein had a special on what he thought, you know, a big respected man in the classical field, were really outstanding things. And of course the Beatles got in there, and I remember Society's Child was one that he brought up, and after he brought it up in that program, it started to create quite a stir, and it went back in the air and became a fairly big hit. This social comment thing is really,
but there must be things that you feel strongly about that is there never any tendency for them to leak through into the song?
Oh yeah, we did one. Mr. Gooder was the name of it. It was on our Close to You LP, and that was the whole thing about backstabbers.
Mr. Gooder, say, Mr. Gooder, may I have a moment with you? For there is something I've got to say, and please don't let scare you away. Mr. Gooder, say, Mr. Gooder, I have seen you go through a day. You're everything a robot lives for. Walk in at 9 and roll out the door at 5. You reflect the company image. You maintain their rules to live by. Shine your shoes, let's keep a neat haircut now that you're wearing the coat and tie. Mr. Gooder, say, Mr. Gooder, someday soon you may realize you've found your life just playing a game where no one wins but everyone stays the same. Mr. Gooder, say, Mr. Gooder, someday soon you may realize you've thrown your life just playing a game where no one wins but everyone stays the same.
It's a tune that you don't have to get, you don't have to think about. It's just, it's easy to sing, and it's happy, and it's a lot of fun.
It's not syrupy by any means, but it's a
lot of fun. The lyrics are very good. I mean, they're easy to understand, yet they're not dumb lyrics. You know, they're very together lyrics. And they, like with Sing, which we understand wasn't that big over here, but it was huge in the States. That song, you can't get tired of it, you know, because it's just something that you go around whistling all day, you know.
It's just a very light song.
Yeah.
Together in the I believe it was rather an impromptu thing. You had some people, some kids in there or something?
Well, we did a TV show, Robert Young with the Young, and saying this from an educational TV show in the States called Sesame Street. And part of the Robert Young with the Young show was Artie Johnson, who was a star of a program that's off the air now. It was called Latin. Was to sing it on the Robert Young show, and the rest of the guests on the show, it was a Sandy Duncan and us and Bob Young, were to do the la-la parts. And by the time we had done the show, it kind of grew on us, and I thought it would be a change of pace, that it would be a hit. So we went and recorded it, and we had a group of 12 kids on there.
Yeah. It's really... It's a really nice tune, you know, and when you sing it, it's a pretty song. It really is, and it's really a kick to sing it. And when we do it in the States in concert, we get kids from each school, each local school, and it's really funny. I mean, because you get all these kids up there, and their shoelaces are untied, and the one's poking the other one to sing louder, and it's just a cute, cute thing. You know? The audience loves it. You know, and it gives the kids a chance, and it's.
Do you ever feel any sort of guilt about not the success, but the rewards that it brings into you that are so vast and so out of proportion?
They are. But there's a lot. It's not just music. It's not just entertainment. There's a lot of professions that if you happen to become successful at, really, really. Bring in a lot of money, you know. We talk about that quite a bit. Our manager and all this, we're talking about how much, you know, it can bring in and how out of proportion it is, you know. But
it seems that, you know, like in saying that it does get a little ridiculous. But I don't think there's any amount of money that you can tag on making somebody happy and giving them what they want, you know. And people don't have to come to see you, and a lot of times, you know, if it makes them feel better, then why not, you know?
Love, look at the two of us, strangers in many ways.
Just don't open up your mouth and do a show. It involves an enormous amount of work. It you employ many, many, many people.
Yeah.
Just to set up and do a show is an all-day job. And we carry like 23 or 24 people with us. And every one of them is just as important as the people that are on the stage. You carry road managers and lighting directors and guys that pack up those huge sound systems and trucks and planes.
Sound engineers.
And I mean, it's just, it takes a lot of thought, and it takes a lot of money to keep it going, and a lot of trouble and a lot of hard work.
It is a lot of work, and it's like an all year, all day.
Definitely, it's a 24-hour job.
Just about.
And it can also impair your health. I mean, because when you're running 24 hours a day and not getting any sleep and not having the time to eat right, you can get damn sick, man. You really can.
How much of your life is spent living like this, living out of a suitcase and traveling around?
Well,
how much
traveling, it's got to be a good 6 months. Not all at once, but through the year, it's got to be
at least
6 months. Mm. It takes us a good 3 months, and it's going to take more, I'd say 4 months, to get an album together. And 3 months just recording it. And
a solid month mixing it easy.
Yeah, and also then researching and finding the material and ideas.
Yes.
And that's what I mean. That's the type of thing where you're always thinking. It's not like at 5 o'clock your job's done for the day. It's not that type of thing, because your mind's always on it.
Do you enjoy this traveling, this 6 months out of the year?
We like to travel, and we love to perform. But I'm telling you, when you get sick, you don't care about anything. And being sick on the road is a miserable experience because there's nothing you can do about it. You can't stop. The only way you can stop is die. I mean, that's the only way you can stop a show, really.
Have you gone through that? Really sick on the road?
Oh,
yeah,
definitely.
She really was.
I've gotten to the point of where I've had like tracheobronchitis and your throat bleeds and you're up there singing, with a sweat just from a fever. I mean, you couldn't care less if you fell over. And we've done some shows like that in 40 below 0 degree weather. And, you get so sick that I've gotten to the point sometimes, I have a pillow in my bass drum, because it makes it sound great. And I've gotten to the point sometimes of where just waiting to do the show, I'll take the pillow out and sleep on it. And then, you just go up there like, I'll never get through this, and you're just bopping around. And there's been a couple of times where you're so out of it that you're lucky if you don't fall off the stage. I mean, but people, you can't tell an audience that you don't feel well. I mean, because it's not fair to them.
Some sleepless night, if you should find yourself alone. Silent understanding, a loving touch. Come to me when things go wrong, and there's no love to light the way.
Let me be the one you run to. Let me be the one you come to when you need someone to turn to. Let me be the one you run to.
You mentioned just now about the length of time you were in the studio doing an album. How long did you say? 4 months, maybe?
Yeah, 3 to 4. It takes a long time because we select all the material and record the tracks. Karen does the drumming, I do the piano, and then on top of the piano. And then for sound, we like to do as little as possible at a time. In other words, we won't have for a track more than 3 instruments at one time. So it's bass, piano, and drums, and that's it to start with. So that means if you want to put a guitar on, that takes more time to do it by itself, but it ends up sounding better. There's less leakage. It takes time to do all the voices with just the two of us. It takes time because I like to put electric piano on top of the piano, or an organ, or harpsichord, or just a celeste, and then there's the orchestrations, which I do. So that's time to think about them, and then do them, conduct them, and it just takes 3 to 4 months. And then the mixing takes almost as long as it does to record, because that's every bit as important.
It is.
I'm thinking, for instance, about that, do you remember the recording of that incredible Bacharach medley on one of the old albums?
Right.
The doing of that. Do you remember the doing of that? Did you?
Sure.
It was all obviously
see,
done
that,
in
little
that bits.
That one was a shortened down version of the original Bacharach medley, which I regret we didn't do. The original Bacharach medley that
13
we is 13 minutes and really is way better than the one on the album. Also, it was orchestrated, which the one on the album is. And really, other things took longer to do than the Bacharach medley.
That came out pretty fast.
Because we did it, all that was on it was electric piano, bass, drums, and that electric clarinet for
plus
the track.
We cut the track with the group.
Yeah, that's one of the few times we used more, and we wouldn't do it anymore. That's a pretty old thing. We did it several years ago. We did that all at once, and we had done it in concert a hundred times, so that we just walked in the studio and did it and got the feel.
It's like the second take or something.
So, in other words, it took much, much longer to record Goodbye to Love than it did the Bacharach medley.
Why was Goodbye to Love? Why did that take such a long time?
Well, it had quite a few things on there. It was the bass, piano, and drums to start with. Then there was all the time, and the guy who played the guitar solo on it's brilliant, but he doesn't read music. He doesn't have to read music, really. He's got such an ear. So he had to come in by himself. I had to sing him the melody, because I wanted melody to begin with on the guitar. Then I wanted him to improvise. So then I had to write out the chord changes just on a piece, like on a napkin.
Yeah.
And then we just kept doing it over and over until we got it exactly the way that we all felt it should be. There was an orchestration thing to it. There were strings and oboe. There was an electric piano on top of it and a lot of vocals. It was a very, very difficult song, phrasing-wise. Not too many places to take a breath for Karen to sing.
And one breath of verse.
And then the hardest thing of all with Goodbye to Love after all that was the mixing. We did over 200 mixes in mono and in stereo, because I believe, you know, that stereo should of course go on the LP and to the consumer, but for AM radio they should get a mono. And there was so many things going in and out on that record that it just took hundreds of mixes to get it.
4 things on each track. All the time.
I'll say goodbye to love. No one ever cared if I should live or die. Time and time again, the chance for love has passed me by. And all I know of love is how to live without it. I just can't seem to find it. I'd say goodbye to love. There are no tomorrows for this heart of mine. Surely time will lose these bitter memories, and I'll find that there is someone to believe in and to live for. Something I could live for. All the years of useless search have finally reached an end. I'll say goodbye to
get sick of those songs and spending that amount of time on them in the studio by the time it actually gets to getting on stage and doing them, or do you give them a new lease of life? Do you change them around and do things?
I only got sick of a couple of them. Really, on the whole, no.
I don't think so, no. Uh-uh.
Like, Goodbye to Love, I never did.
No.
And it has nothing to do because it's my tune. In other words, I never got sick of We've Only Just Begun or a Superstar. Never got sick of Superstar. Rainy Days wore on me.
Mm. But never on Karen. That's one of my favorite because I love to
sing.
You know,
Close to You. As far as doing it in person, probably because we've been doing that one longer than any of the others. You know, it was the first big hit. And
you mentioned, I'm just leaping, you mentioned Superstar, and your interpretation of it is rather different from the original and from the Bette Midler. Bette Midler does a very different interpretation.
Right.
How did you see that song?
Well, Richard heard that on the Carson show one night.
That's a talk show.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. And Bette Midler was doing it that night. And
that's before she made it.
Yeah.
Johnny Carson used to have her on all the time.
Yeah.
She was on like about a year to 2 years before
she
got a recording contract and caught on.
But you had known that it was on the Cocker album.
Well, it was on Mad Dogs and Englishmen.
Right.
Rita Coolidge did it.
But Bette did it as, what do you say, like kind of
a torch thing.
Or,
she just really did it, sort of free, not with that much beat, really.
But that night, he heard it by himself. And when I heard it on the Cocker album, it didn't do that much for me.
That was the only one where I had to care.
Right.
I didn't care for it. And when I heard that hook, even though
Rita Coolidge do it, and it didn't knock me out, you know. And he said, "Look out, man!" You know,
smash. I mean, I really.
And he. But I mean, when we got done with it, and don't take that the way that came out. It sounded funny. This always sounds funny when I say this, but when it was finished, it really pleased us. I mean, it's
that's
a beautiful,
like
beautiful song. Mm. But you arranged the crap out of it. I mean, it was just, you really did a number on that tune. And to this day, it's definitely one of our favorites.
Baby, baby, baby.
something you do in the studio, which must take an awful long time, is this building up
the vocals.
Oh yeah, this over and over and
so
over.
So you got two people,
yeah,
and there's one chord on the Close to You album, and I'll Never Fall in Love Again, which is a Battercrack David tune. It's a 13 separate part, overdubbed three times. That's 39 voices out of two people. It took a while. That's what I mean.
Each one has to be perfect, because if you don't double it perfectly, you can't triple it. You know, and in other words,
we sing each part three times, so they have to be attacked the same, they have to be released the same, so you don't get any right. If you say, let's say, the word "past," that means when you sing it again, it has to be said the
same.
Has to release the same as the other one, or you're going to get stumped. And that can really start getting sloppy if you just say, you know, and you let it go and you just keep stacking them up. It can really get sloppy.
Not only you have to match yourself, but we have to match each other. Because if you've got 50 million going all over the place, it's going to sound like Donald Duck. I mean, you know, it's really touchy. And some of them come out the minute you do them. And others, you could stand there and sing them over and over. You're going, what am I doing wrong? You know?
Yeah.
What do you get when you fall in love? A guy with a pin to burst your bubble. That's what you get for all your trouble. I'll never fall in love again. What do you get when you kiss a guy? You get enough germs to catch pneumonia. After you do, he'll never fall ya. Never fall in love again. I'll never fall in love again. Don't tell me what it's all about, 'cause I've been there and I'm glad I'm out. Out of those chains that bind you. That is why I'm here to remind you. What do you get when you fall in love? You get enough tears to fill an ocean. That's what you get for your devotion. I never fall in love again. I never fall in love again. Sorrow so far at least until tomorrow. I never fall in love again. I'll never fall in love again.
Think alike, you two?
Exactly.
There's a couple of things I can't even think of offhand that we don't. I mean, it has nothing to do with music. It's something, very few things that we don't do the same. But boy, when it comes to music or just about everything,
yeah.
We do think exactly alike.
So you are very close offstage. You live together, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
You,
yes.
You have a house together.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That also helps to, I think that's one of the things that's kept the whole group together, because the whole group is exactly, it's one big family, and it's, believe me, that helps when you're on the road that much, spending 24 hours a day with anybody. If you don't get along with them, you might as well just pack it up.
How How do you see yourselves in the future? What do you see lying ahead for the Carpenters? Just continuing the same, or do you have any goals in mind?
No, we just want to continue doing what we've been doing.
You don't have an eventual thing up in the sky where you'd like to get to this or do this? Because you've done practically everything.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, to me, the last thing I had a goal-wise was writing a number one record.
Yeah.
And happen to have two in the last year, and so I'm pretty well satisfied. I just want to keep it going.
Yeah, that's a goal in itself. Because each time you get a hit,
that's something.
It's twice as hard to get another one. And after you've gotten, we've been lucky enough to have 14
gold records. Yeah.
And I mean, each time you put one out, you cross your fingers a little tighter. I mean, because it could stop any day, and it's not up to us. It's up to our audience. And it's always, people always say, "Oh, if you get one hit, you're set." Blog. Forget it. Like I said before, you can flop as fast as you hit. And it's, like we said before, it's a 24-hour-a-day thing. Mm-hmm. Trying to stay ahead of it all.
It's a long way
down. Keeps
you
very busy.
Why do birds suddenly appear every time you are near? Just like me, they long to be close to you. Why do stars fall down from the sky every time you walk by? Just like me, they long to be close to you. On the day that you were born, the angels got together and decided to create a dream come true. So they sprinkled moon dust in your hair and golden starlight in your eyes of blue. That is why all the girls in town follow you around. Just like me, they love. Close to you.